Yeah, let's jump into it. Knee osteoarthritis, OA, is a degenerative disease leading to pain and a decreased range of motion. And MRI is commonly used to assess the grade of OA, and image-based biomarkers show potential for diagnosis of OA, for treatment planning on for prognostic purposes. However, large-scale data sets and automated methods are needed to handle large-scale data sets, such as data from the Osteoarthritis Initiative, OAI, which contains 50,000 MRIs of different knees for several time points. And if a single human had to segment all of these images, it would take him 50,000 hours or 24 years working full-time. So that's why segmentation of knees has always been important. It was especially already important in 2010. And in 2010, the MICAI Sky 10 Grand Challenge was hosted. And this challenge is still kept alive, and you can still submit your segmentations to the website. And the data of the Sky 10 Challenge was acquired using different scanners and different MRI sequences. Manual segmentations were provided for bones and for cartilage, and the data is structured into 60 training, 40 validation, and 50 submission files. Don't get confused here for time points. Baseline means in our context that's time point zero, and 12 months is 12 months later. So we have got a different data set, an OAI data set. 88 segmentations of cartilage were provided by Imorphix. And at our institute, the Zuse Institute Berlin, ZIP, we created manual segmentations for bones and cartilage for 507 subjects. Okay, I already mentioned the Sky 10 Challenge has been hosted in 2010. These are the original results, and the top two teams, Imorphix and ZIP, both used somehow statistical shape knowledge. And since this is a conference on deep learning, statistical shape models are maybe not known by everyone, so I would like to briefly introduce statistical shape models. The main idea of statistical shape models, SSM, is to capture the geometrical variability within a certain population of shapes, or in the medical context of anatomies. A shape is represented as a point cloud, and all shapes in our population have pointwise correspondence. The mean shape is now given as the arithmetic mean of all shapes. Using principal component analysis between the differences of all points and the mean, shape modes of variation, xi, are calculated. Finally, a shape instance is given as the mean plus a linear combination of shape weights and the shape modes of variation. These statistical shape models can be used within a segmentation method to generate geometrically plausible segmentation masks. Since 2010, many other teams have submitted results to the Sky 10 Challenge, and so did we again some months ago. Many of these new methods now employ machine learning. So while statistical shape model-based methods explicitly consider geometrical information, they usually need an appearance model which was designed for one specific MRI sequence. And usually this appearance model is hand-designed, and it is very challenging to design it by hand for all this variation which can appear across MRI sequences, across patients, and across the structure of interest itself. So, and this is causing problems. On the other hand, machine learning-based approaches are often trained end-to-end. They need no manual intervention and achieve impressive results. However, they do not or rarely explicitly consider shape information. So the motivation for our segmentation method was to combine statistical shape models and CNNs in a clever way. So that's maybe similar to the talk given by Mr. Taylor. We want to improve the confidence in our segmentation in areas where CNNs maybe are confused. So our first step, CNN2D, is similar to a 2D unit. However, we adjusted the input of our network such that one 2D MRI slice plus 16 slices around it are supplied to add some kind of context information within our three-dimensional MRI dataset. This is, however, despite our efforts, not yielding plausible three-dimensional segmentations. Here you can see a femoral bone, and correct segmentation is shown here in dashed. So errors occur in areas of low contrast or in areas of image artifacts. To overcome these issues, we added shape information. In particularly, we adjusted a statistical shape model to our CNN2D mask, and this is yielding geometrically plausible segmentations. This is very nice. Even in areas of strange effects, we are getting now a good segmentation, but this is some kind of regularization. So we would want to also capture small details in our segmentation. As you can see here, again shown with dashed lines, they are regularized away and removed from our segmentation. And in our context of bone segmentation, these small changes are pathological bony growths, also called bone spurs or osteophytes. And we would like to include them in our segmentation. For this reason, we added another step, CNN3D, a three-dimensional CNN. And this step is starting with a sampling. So we're sampling from roughly 100,000 outline points and get sparser to 1,000 points, which are nicely distributed in space. And for each of these points, we sample MRI subvolumes. These subvolumes are really three-dimensional, and we segment them with our 3D CNN. So let's have a look at one MRI subvolume and our CNN architecture. Our CNN architecture is similar to our architecture employed in the 2D case, but augmented into 3D, so our input is really a three-dimensional image, and we use three-dimensional convolution. Here you can see one subvolume and an segmentation for it. We chose the size of our subvolume as large as possible to still be trainable on our GPUs, considering memory limitations. So we only have 11 gigabytes of memory on our GPU. And this is adding nice small details to our segmentation masks, these osteophytes. However, this CNN3D step is not always successful. But we will get to that. First, we extracted not only three subvolumes, but subvolumes at every point. And those subvolumes are, of course, often overlapping. So we have to somehow merge these subvolumes into one segmentation mask. To do this, we did a little trick or whatever. A classification of bone is considered as plus one, shown in blue. And the classification of no bone is now considered as minus one for our voting scheme. We did this not only for three boxes, subvolumes, but for all 1,000 in this case, which is shown here. Don't get confused. Those are the same subvolumes. We only changed the color map here. Now, if we really sum it up for 1,000 subvolumes, we get this nice encoding where red is a high confidence that it's no bone, and blue is a high confidence of bone. We also consider our SSM, which was adjusted to the CNN2D step, and counted at 25 upvotes for bone. As you can see in this middle area, which wouldn't be covered by our CNN3D, we now have 25 votes for bone, which is nice, such that our bone is filled. We now perform a voxel-wise decision. For each voxel, if the value is larger than zero, it is counted as bone. And we get our bone segmentation mask. So as I already mentioned, this is working fine if all images are normal and have a nice contrast. But we often come across MRI datasets where the contrast is very bad in some areas, as shown here. Our segmentation is over-segmenting for the shaft of the bones. To overcome this issue, we again used statistical shape knowledge in our SSM post-processing step. For this reason, we defined an area of high trust into our statistical shape model, here shown in blue, and an area of low trust, shown in yellow. For these yellow areas, we know that here osteophytes might occur. And for the blue area, we know that we can easily trust our statistical shape model. Following now a certain set of rules, we can remove those overlapping three-dimensional connected components from our segmentation mask, because we can easily trust our SSM in this region. This is finishing our bone segmentation, and we can now segment a lot of bones fully automatically. It takes around 6 minutes for both bones on a workstation. Okay, for segmentation of cartilage, we use knowledge of two aspects. First, the femoral cartilage and the tibial cartilage is always located on the respective bone, which was segmented before. And the second aspect is that, especially for arthritic knees, cartilage lesions can appear at any location and with any severity. So for cartilage segmentation, we couldn't employ a geometrical prior, but we only used a CNN 3D step. However, we used shape knowledge to reduce our bone surface for the femur here shown to the condyle region where cartilage can occur. Again, we sampled positions at the outline, extracted subvolumes, and segmented them with a CNN 3D, which is identical to the CNN used in the bone case. The fully automated segmentation of bone and cartilage takes around 9 minutes on the workstation. So, for the Sky 10 challenge data, we achieved for the first time an average total score greater than 75. This score of 75 is equal to an expert segmentation as defined in the Sky 10 setup. And for the OAI amorphics data set, we achieved results better than the results reported by Dam et al. For the zero time point. However, Dam et al. Only reported the dissimilarity coefficient and only for one time point. We additionally evaluated different metrics, for example, the average surface distance. And for both data sets, the OAI amorphics and the OAI zip data set, our mean average surface distance is below image resolution. Also, we will make our manual segmentations of our OAI zip data sets, these 507 segmentations of bone and cartilage, publicly available as part of the medical image analysis extended version, such that new methods can compare their results to our results or even train on our data. Yeah, so is the problem of knee segmentation now solved? Now that we achieved a result as good as a human expert for the Sky 10 data, from our side, no. The fibular bone and cartilage are still missing. The patella bone and cartilage. The fibular bone is still missing, and ligaments also. We can not segment ligaments right now. However, we have recently published a method for segmentation of knee menisci. Remaining problems are other modalities than MRI, all those different MRI sequences, and how to handle image artifacts, endoprosthesis, and pathological changes. Maybe it's helpful to segment osteophytes, inflammations, and lesions or tears separately from the bones or structure, which is considered, to aid in diagnosis of OA. And also we are planning to combine statistical shape models and CNN further. Okay, thank you and best wishes from Stefan, who is also here, Moritz, who isn't here, and Felix, who is at home with Caro, who will give birth probably in 2 days to Lena.
So thank you very much also for the talk and for leaving time for questions. Any questions from the audience? Okay, then I will start. First of all, thank you again for not only the contribution, but also for announcing the publication of the data set. Have you considered not releasing the full data set, but creating another challenge from that data?
We didn't consider that, but if there's interested, that's a great idea, yeah?
I could imagine that this could be worthwhile. Okay, please, if you have any further questions, Brown?
Yeah, very nice work. I'm wondering, you have to decide whether you trust your shape model or your CNN.
Yeah.
And you seem to define zones where you trust one or the other.
Yeah.
That seems a bit ad hoc, right? And in principle, these abnormalities could also occur in other regions, so the shape model might not always be reliable in these other regions. Can you think of learning this from the data? Or?
Of course, this is one of our next steps for really combining statistical shape models and CNNs in a more direct way to learn these areas where errors might occur, and maybe also to learn the variability which is in our data, in our geometrical shapes, to not explicitly build a statistical shape model, but maybe incorporate it in our CNN as a layer, or to learn the shape weights, to not use this heuristic approach, which is really specific to our problem of knee bone segmentation, where we have a good guess where those deformations might occur. But yeah, we want to work on that.
Okay, two more questions from the audience.
Do you know yet how to combine these things, how to combine your statistical shape models within a deep learning network?
There are two possibilities from my side. The first possibility is I mentioned in the beginning of my talk that statistical shape models are usually driven by an appearance model to the MRI data, and you could learn this appearance model with a CNN, so that a CNN is deciding for the statistical shape model how to deform for a given MRI data set. That's one possibility. The other possibility is to learn the variability of your shapes implicitly, more in an implicit way, in a CNN. So learn shapes and learn in which areas you can trust your shapes, in which areas you have variability, in which areas you don't have it, and learn this end to end.
Yeah, thank you for your interesting talk. Just a quick question. So in the I didn't see why you need in the first step applying your shape model. So it's just for finding the positions where you apply then the 3D unit, and so you could also take the just the surface pixels from the from the first. So why do you, when anyhow you apply 1,000 units, then might not matter if they are exactly aligned to some shape model or?
Can I go back to a picture?
Yeah. I don't know.
I will try.
I don't mind.
For really severe artifacts, where do we have it? Such as shown here, our unit segmentation is here, and we would, wrong direction, desire a segmentation in this way. So our subvolumes are now more or less small and only looking 32 pixels in this direction. So they wouldn't see this boundary here. That's why we need a statistical shape model-based regularization such that our subvolumes are really seeing this area.
Okay.
And also they would maybe make a false decision in this case because they wouldn't expect such a wide area inside a black bone.
Yeah, thank you. I think that would be called an ablation study to leave that step away. Did you do any other ablation studies, leaving other parts of this whole pipeline away?
No.
Okay, but then
we could think about it, yeah.
Yeah. Thank you. And I think it's time for the next and final talk in this session.